Okay, let's start now. I think more or less everyone is here. Hi everyone, I am Laura Iosifescu, the founder of the multi-award winning Laura I.Art Gallery, and I will be your host tonight. Our not-for-profit art gallery is a little yet visionary hub for arts and culture. Sorry, I need a bit of water. It happens. So its existence has never been more important than in today's society. Humankind is facing many challenges at the moment, from the pandemic, poverty, global warming, inequality, and races, to mention only a few. We are in strong need of diversity and creative thinking to face these challenges. And that's why we are here today. That's our mission, to give a voice to the unheard. We believe this world can be enriched and voiced through art. We aim to utilize art as a medium to engage, educate, and express. We focus our strength on strengthening communities and improving lives through extraordinary cultural experiences such as this event today. We are experiencing a moment in history that calls for global cooperation and solidarity among nations as the world continues to battle the COVID-19 pandemic. As cliché as it sounds, I do believe in the goodness of humanity, and I think art and technology can bring out the best of us, making us feel and live in a more united way, reaching out to people all over the world and sharing art and positivity. We are hosting this important live event to present you three amazing people who have played an amazing role in making this world a better place, each one in their own incredible way. Before I introduce you, our guests, and our program tonight, I would like to announce that we have now launched our online store and we have over 300 artworks in our collection. All those wonderful artworks are just waiting to be picked and loved with the same intensity they offer back to us. Purchasing an artwork from us means not only directly supports the artist, but also helping to re-stimulate and invigorate the art market. When you purchase one or more of our artworks, you are demonstrating unparalleled support for our diverse community and participating in our mission. We are representing 15 incredible artists from around the world through our partnership with the top leading organization, Arty, the number one platform for collecting art where only leading galleries, museums, and art auctions are showcased. We have now opened the second stage of recruitment, and we are looking 50 more artists to take on board with us on this fantastic journey of growth and expression. Our artists have never just focused on producing art in their studio space. They all have a mission in this world, as they wish to play a part in society and make a difference to people's lives. Through their talent and courage, they can inspire, contribute, and change the world for better. I have the wonderful honor now to officially open the exhibition Hallowed Landscapes, An Epoch of Color, which presents the amazing work of Glenn Badham. Glenn Studio's practice focuses on our national heritage and the place where humankind and nature meet. Based in rural Leicestershire, Glenn's home village is mentioned in the Doomsday Book with an interesting and abundant local history. Heritage is important. It's important because it helps shaping our identity. It is not just something that surrounds us. It actively becomes part of who we are, the expression of the identity of the land and its heritage reveals what matters most to us. It highlights our values and priorities, depicting identity as an ever-changing flux. Glenn is extremely drawn to record and represent this flux of identity within the landscape, following the land as it continues to evolve around him. In his work, Glenn provides us clues to our past, helping us examine our history and traditions while enabling us to develop a more profound awareness of ourselves in relation to nature. Now, before I ask you, Glenn, a few questions about your work, I would like to introduce our very special guest. They are truly, truly incredible, not only because of their amazing achievements, but also because of the way they constantly champion and advocate for art. They're also really big fans, of course, of Glenn's work. I would like to now share a short testimonial clip with Lee Benson, who is, you may know, an author, musician, and former gallery owner. He is here with us tonight, and he will be closing our event with a few words about the exhibition and Glenn's painting. Now I'm gonna share my screen.
Hello everyone, so here we've got Lee Benson, known Lee for a long, long time, a great, great guy, and he's going to say a few words about a couple of pieces of my work that he owns.
Hello everybody. Yes, I've known Glenn since I opened up my gallery in 1999 in the middle of Birmingham. Two incredible examples of two ends of the world. This I bought from Glenn when I had my gallery, and it's been proudly sitting on my wall in my own home here for the last 6 years. But I actually bought on one of his first or second visits, I think, and I just had to keep it. And this picture, which I travelled, having closed my gallery, all the way to, where was it?
Northampton.
The Durnger. Just when we were allowed to wear a mask in lockdown, and I went to his exhibition, and I bought this. And today, more or less a year later, he's actually delivered it, which is wonderful. The comparison between the two, apart from the vibrancy of the colours, is what Glenn's about. There is a hidden mood within this painting. He doesn't try to just capture a person sitting. He tries to capture beyond what you're actually looking at, which is a bit like real life. Look beyond what you're looking at. It's not what you see, it's more. You have to think, you have to feel, you have to smell. With this beautiful little picture here, this is obviously a seascape. However, in the eyes of Glenn, it's more than a seascape.
Hi, Ollie. I'm not sure if you've heard the last thing I've said. Didn't you when I was introducing Ollie? No, okay, yeah, I was on mute. Okay, so now I would like to reintroduce you if you didn't hear me this the first time, our second guest, the amazing Ollie Mortensen, who is, I'm sure you all have heard of Ollie, is a Danish director of cricket and former Derby County Cricket Club captain and paceman. Hi, Ollie. Thank you so much for being with us today. Can you hear us? Hi, Ollie.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes. Ah, there we go. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Part of this, you know, if in any way I can support Glenn, you know, it's a great honor for me because I met Glenn back in 1994. And I knew straight when I saw him the first minute that this person here is very, very special and very talented. So I'm honored to be part of this exhibition tonight. It's gonna be good.
Thank you. I know that you have purchased one or a few pieces from Glenn's work. What inspires you the most when you look at Glenn's painting?
Oh, how many hours have you got?
Enough.
His versatility, you know, he's a master of details, and then he can paint, and you have to guess or use your imagination. It's just his talent is so broad. And a true story was I met him and his father-in-law at a pub in Derbyshire, and I showed him a drawing of me jumping around in a Viking costume, and his father-in-law said, this drawing of you jumping around in a Viking costume, that's not very good. And I thought it was pretty good. And then I got introduced to Glenn, and Glenn didn't have a lot of knowledge about cricket, and I invited him because straight away the chemistry between Glenn and I was fantastic. So I invited him to the county grounds, and I said to Glenn, can you do me a painting about the county grounds? And he said, sure. And to cut a very long story short, a couple of weeks later, he's drawn this amazing, amazing painting. And as you can see, I got a couple of paintings in the background. That's one has he done. That's from Lords, the West Indies playing England. And this one is from the nursery. And can you all see that? Masterpiece. And let me just give you a tour. I got another, that's one of the first paintings we brought from Glenn. And that's a picture which made me through the COVID-19. Can you see that?
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. It is absolutely world-class. And every day I have to go in, and instead of taking some medicine, I just look at this picture and I find new angles and detailing in this picture is absolutely world-class. And that's a matter of fact, it's Vicky's wardrobe. It's one of his earlier pieces, but the guy is sensational. Not just a good friend, but he's so talented, it's unbelievable. If he's not painting, he's a star on the ballroom dancing. So, yeah, he should be knighted.
Definitely, definitely. You said that you prefer Glenn's work over medicines. How important do you think art is it in your home?
I couldn't live without art. I got a number of paintings. I've been fortunate enough to meet a number of artists during my time in England. But Glenn Badham stands out as the number one. I can only say that during the COVID lockdown in Denmark and like everywhere else in Europe, or a matter of fact, around the world, Glenn's paintings have made me come through the COVID, because either I walked to, we were fortunate enough to live near a forest, and I walked or jogged in the forest, and if not, I just went in my living room and just admired the paintings done by Glenn. And it's good for my blood pressure, it's good for my well-being, so it's just fantastic. He's so talented.
Definitely. Oli, would you recommend Glenn's art to more people, and why, once again?
Yeah, of course. I've been trying for a number of years to have Glenn to come to Copenhagen to make have an exhibition. What I like about Glenn is his versatility. He's done the latest gallery with the British coastline and the British, that's just the nature. And he's, the way he's drawing those paintings is just unbelievable. I want to buy them all, but I haven't got room in my house. But there was one particular painting I'm going to buy it of Glenn if he hasn't already sold it. It was a little boy, it might be Theo, playing in the sand near the beach. And it was a very simple painting, but it had the benchmark of Glenn Badham. And I just, when I saw it, I said, I need to get my hands on that painting. But as I said, I'm repeating myself. It was one of the best days of my life when I met Glenn and his father-in-law at that pub in Derbyshire, because he's enriched not just myself, but the whole family's life. He's painting. He came to Denmark. He painted, made a drawing of my two daughters, Emilia and Julie. And those two paintings, they were sold within seconds. And I would like to find out who's got those paintings so I can buy them back. Maybe I can have a chat with Glenn and find out who has my daughters hanging somewhere in the UK.
It's fantastic. What a fantastic story. Thank you so much, Oli, for, wonderful description of Glenn's paintings. Wow, such an inspiring words. Thank you. Thank you so much.
It's me. It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure supporting Glenn and supporting you good people and what you're trying to achieve. So you got my 100% full backing. So anytime.
Thank you so much. And now, Ben, I've got a few questions for you. However, I would prefer to hear from our audience first. So has anyone got any question for Glenn about his work, content, context, and why not technique or approach? Please raise your hand if you do have. Any questions for Glenn? Yeah, please raise your hand, or you can, if you do not speak, please write your question in the chat box.
Hi Glenn, I just wanted to ask you, seeing as you have countless of pieces of artwork that you have, is there one in particular that if you had the chance to actually live in, would you? Which would be the one that you would actually live in for the rest of your life, if you had the option to?
So, is that's directed at me, sorry. Yeah. Just broke then. Sorry, Emmanuel. Welcome, everybody. I'll just answer Emmanuel's question. Hi, Ollie. That was fabulous. Good to see you. So, Emmanuel, probably of the work in this exhibition here, I'll just show you the one I particularly like. If I had to inhabit one painting, it would probably be this piece here. Now,
you might have to zoom the camera just a tiny bit.
Oh, it's gone out of focus. Sorry. Just trying to get
It's still out of focus.
Yeah, it's still out of focus. Oh, it's perfect.
Yeah, that's good.
Is that better now? Yeah. Okay. Sorry about that. Yes, this particular painting, as the introduction said, the work at the moment is underpinned by the history. Now, this particular area, going right back to prehistory, this was underwater. This was a shallow basin in the Caribbean period. So we were about 20 foot deep water. And that's why there's not too much undulation. Around here, we've got these lovely shallow dipping bays and troughs and not too many high points. And this particular, you might be able to see there, Martin Trussell, just directly behind you here is the airfield. And that was the World War II airfield. Wellington bombers were going over towards the end of the war to attack Northern Europe. But just behind you, a few years ago, 70 years ago, there would have been the thundering of Polish pilots taking Wellington bombers over there. In prehistory, it was, as I say, underwater, shallow bay, and they found Neolithic remains 3,500 years ago. There were people living here, and in even stone circles and Saxon and Iron Age remains. So there's this wonderful context about the place, but I just love this particular spot. You're just dropping down towards the wonderful hill here, and this is going up one side, it's Lebanon, and this side here is going towards Market Harbour and out towards Rutland Water. So if any of you know Leicestershire, Rutland Water, out of this direction here. I just love this big sweeping, it's part of the Welland Valley. So there's this lovely undulating, meandering river running through. And just at this time of night, you get the shadow cutting right through. This time of year, it's wonderful. So this headgear cutting, and the shadows falling through that bay, through that, what was it, bay, now is the Welland Valley. It's just a delightful spot to stand and look. It feels like you're looking forever. So if the painters tonight answer your question briefly, that would be a lot. Any more?
Thank you so much, Emmanuel, for your questions. Has anybody, okay, Ollie, yes, please. You're free. Ollie, you got a question for Glenn?
Yes, I definitely got a question for Glenn. The first one is, I'm taking the opportunity here to invite Glenn and his family to Copenhagen, because they haven't been in Copenhagen for a very long time. The next one I ask Glenn about, paintings and what mindset have you got for the future? Now we're coming out of the corona. Have you got a new theme on the radar so that we can enjoy? Just let me hear about your plans for the future.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's a big question.
No, that's fine. Thank you very much, Ollie and Lee. Thank you for the testimony. It was lovely to see you both. Now, the work is just progressing towards. It's been in my statement for a while, but there's that threshold, especially where I live in Leicestershire. There's a constant development, there's a constant expansion where the development is just moving towards nature. And then sometimes nature pushes back. So I've done some paintings and drawings of this threshold, almost this interface where man's development meets nature's pushback. It's quite interesting. I've done just in the last year quite a few pieces, and they all seem to have this little white sign in them When you go over and have a look at this little white sign, it's normally a planning order that something is going to be built. This is going to be knocked down in place of that. And this was just accidental to begin with, but it's something I've noticed. It's happening a lot. Barn conversions, some of it's wonderful. And this goes right back to the landscape gardeners, Capability Brown, where we've always managed our landscape. And if you've got the money enough for a stately home, you wanted the views from your stately home to be exquisite. And you'd get somebody to make that happen. Nature wasn't quite good enough. We had to improve it. And they'd even tether animals so that there was a little cow in the right spot. That's how extreme it went. So sometimes it's done exquisitely, sometimes not so, but there's this threshold. And that's what I absolutely love. I noticed it when I was down in Devon. Obviously, with lockdown, I've not been able to get there. But with Devon, you've got certain areas like Woolacombe Bay that are packed with 10,000 people. And then you go a mile down the road to Morthoe and you'll see two people in the day. And there's this total contrast. And I've noticed it more and more in Leicestershire through the lockdown, being pinned to my local area, this constant change, this flux, this development between the expansion of our necessity for growth and building and nature fighting back. There's a wonderful reservoir near here, and I did a drawing. It's just been selected for the Mal Galleries, and it's of the old pump house for the reservoir, now derelict, and it's a wonderful spot because the trees are pushing, they've taken the roof off and they're coming through the walls, and what was once this pump house sending the water to the local vicinity is now a derelict ruin, and nature is taking it back. So that at the moment is that's where the work's going. I'm working on a large charcoal currently of the gravel pits, which are just on the edge of the village. And it literally looks like the Somme. You wouldn't know it was a beautiful village in the middle of Leicestershire. It's got barbed wire and fence posts and troughs full of water. It's an incredible image. So keep your eyes open. I'll be posting that up. I did a little posting yesterday while I was out working on it. But it's that interface, it's that threshold where man meets nature, and there's a bit of a push back. And that is where I'm really excited at the moment. That's where the work is going.
Fantastic, Glenn. Thank you very much. We got a few more questions from our public. One is from Nicholas, who is asking, are there any places you've painted that you would like to visit again or repaint?
Of course. I'll try and be a bit more brief. I do tend to waffle. Those of you that know me, I can talk for England. Italy. I love Italy. I did a residency quite early on in my career. And I adore Italy. We lived there for 4 months and I had the privilege to work and do a residency with an artist called Cesare Sartori. And that particular region, Veneto, is exquisite. We could see the Alps and the beauty, all the runoff, which is what made it wonderful for ceramics, all the rush-off from those mountains enriched the soil and gave the great clay for ceramics. So the area was filled with ceramicists. It's wonderful. And you were just a stone's throw from Venice, so we could follow our way over to Venice. And the one thing I would like to do now is go back, being so inspired by landscapes. When I was there, I was very much more inspired by figures. So my work was lots and lots of people and interiors. And now I would like to go back with a fresh eye and hit those Alps. Wonderful thing to see. Through the summer, Friday night, clouds would build up all week, and then they couldn't get over the top, and the thunderstorms were amazing. We'd sit with the shutters open and just watch the lightning strafing the Alps. And what a spectacle. You know, you don't have to pay anything for this. It was wonderful. That's where I'd really like to go back to, Veneto, Italy.
Thank you, Glenn. We got one more question from Teresa. She says, your work has amazing color. I was wondering, do you paint outside or work from photographs in the studio?
It's a bit of both. Some I work outside on. So this one, some of it was done outside, mostly in the studio, because this was tail end of January. So it's is how long you can stand the temperature. It was quite cold, but some of that was done live. There's also, I'll just turn the camera slightly. There's also All Saints there. It's got a little bit of light on it. I do apologize. It looks like the sun's coming out. Did the light of the church. Some of that was done live, stood outside. And it's quite nice because you give people a bit of a shock when you stood there painting because they're just not used to it. Wonder what you're up to. Stood there with an easel and a palette. But yeah, that was those two. All Saints, quite a lot of that was done live. This partly live. The rest mostly in the studio. I tend to take sketches. You saw the cricket paintings from Ollie. They were done with little rapid sketches. So I tend to do very quick line drawings and then I expand them into paintings in the studio. So that's the way I tend to work, a drawing expanded in the studio or from life.
Wow, thank you, Glenn. Thank you very much. Wow, it's really busy tonight. Everyone wants to ask you questions, which is fantastic. We got one more question also from Paula. She's asking, do you mainly paint in watercolor, on canvas, canvas board, photographs, imaginary? Maybe you can briefly tell us the beginning, middle, and the end.
Sure. I tend to work oil on canvas. I do use board, this painting here, one of the works. This one here, which is called Broad Lane. This one, that's one of board. The others are all canvas. I like oil, it's a very versatile medium, and I like to use it in the early stages, and this one in particular uses a lot of glazing, which is where the oil is thinned down, heavy on the linseed oil, not so much paint. So the pigment is low, the oil is high. And it means you can glaze light watercolor. I do watercolors, not so much, tend to always work in oil or acrylic, but you get a very, very similar effect, much like the Renaissance painters. Rembrandt was very good at glazing, Rubens. So wonderful history of glazing, and it means you can get these fantastic colors that the paint looks backlit just like it does with watercolor, where you're trying to preserve the white and allow the white to glow through the colors. That's what I try and do with oil. So in some places it's very thick, it's impasto piled on, and then in other areas the white of the ground underneath punches through and you get these kind of backlit areas of the moon punching through the great oak here. And when you see that, there's a lot of paint piled on, but then the sky glows because it's a glaze of blue. So there's a haze almost in that moon.
Superb. Emmanuel's got another question. Emmanuel, would you like to ask your question?
Yeah, sure. So what does your schedule look like when it comes to your daily practice?
Okay. Normally, first up, especially through lockdown, it's been Joe Wicks. First thing in the morning, 30-minute workout, because you know, you've got to keep fit.
Keep in shape.
Not that I'm modest or anything. You've got to try and keep fit. So first thing has been a 30-minute workout with Joe Wicks every day. Normally do that about when my son's gone to school, 8:30 to 9 o'clock, and then it's straight in, get painted. And then I'll tend to paint through till 5 in the evening. And then sometimes if Theo's got after school clubs or things on, then I'll do another session into the evening. So try where possible to get 10 hours a day in the studio working.
Wow.
Lovely. Emmanuel, wow. You've got another question.
Yeah. So this is more for young artists out there, probably even, well, as myself. What advice would you give them?
Well, work ethic is important. As I say, a lot of people think that you can get away with just doing a few hours of work, but as I'm sure you're learning, working with your it is a huge investment, like any job, you know, that you get out what you put in. So you've got to be prepared to work hard. And look for the right contacts. We saw Lee's testimonial earlier. I was very fortunate to find Lee, like Ollie. Very, very fortunate to bump into these guys and they were just chance meetings. Ollie was in a pub, as he said, with my father-in-law, and we just hit it off. And then Leo did take my portfolio in. So that was a conscious effort to promote myself. I took a portfolio in and said, look, would you be interested in what I do? And he said, I'm setting up a gallery, leave it with me. And he came back to me and we had a phenomenal relationship. Such a shame his gallery shut down in 2013, because it was a wonderful venue. And Ollie, if you want to know where those paintings are, you need to speak to Lee, because he's the gentleman that sold them. So he's the man that sold your two daughters' paintings. Okay, so it's fortuitous that we should all have been on together and you asked that question, because the gentleman is on this evening. So yeah, a good work ethic, and don't be afraid to push yourself like that. Meeting Lee, I went into a gallery, nerve-wracking, but you've got to do it. You've got to prepare to promote yourself as much as your studio practice. That's only a small part of it. If you don't keep your social media up, keep promoting yourself and keeping your portfolio and your presentation in the right order, you'll just slip through the cracks, because there are too many that are good at that and they will get the advantage. Hope that helps.
Thank you.
Emmanuel, for your question, and as always, Glenn. So has anyone got any more questions for Glenn before I ask my questions?
Well, one's just popped up from Paula, and she just said, has lockdown affected my focus? And quite the opposite. It has galvanized my productivity. So it gave me the chance to look almost in macro at what was around me, which quite often we don't do. We don't look up and around enough. And for the last year, I've looked all around and I've worked with a greater intensity.
Lee's got a really very, very smart question. Please, Glenn, explain your amazing sketching observation from a young age.
Yeah, sure. Well, one thing I've always, my father was a draftsman. He was a trained draftsman. So he sat and drew with me for many hours when I was young. And I think that helped me get a proficiency with a pencil. I tend to work now with pen and ink on small pads, chiefly because people don't realise what you're doing. You get into a lot less trouble if you're using a little pad, and you get disturbed a bit less. You know, not that I'm antisocial by any means, but people don't realise you're doing it. So you can get away with a little sketch about drawing people and groups, and they won't even realise. And if you're out in the wild sketching,
I think we lost Glenn for a second there. Let's see. While we are fixing our problem, please continue us, write your questions for Glenn in the chat box. And when he is coming back, okay. We apologize for the technical issues. I believe Glenn might have lost his signal. Right. Okay, while we are waiting for Glenn, I would like to announce, we got a big, big surprise for you, a gift, I may call it. We are offering only for today, 10% off from any of Glenn's artworks. So if you are interested to make one of the best deals of your life, please follow our link, which again can be found in the chat box. Is Glenn back now? We got an exhibition without the artist. It happens. I'm sure he's trying to figure out. I know Glenn is not here, but I would like to ask any of you who might want to say something about Glenn's artwork, anyone who may have owns maybe a work of art by Glenn and would like to share their thoughts on their artworks with us.
Hello. Talking about Glenn's sketching, I've actually seen him in action on three occasions. So one, we were just walking in London, walking across a bridge, and there was this rather pretty looking jogger, and she just literally walked by us. And Glenn stopped because he didn't have anything in him, but he stopped and he sort of got a little sketchbook out and drew a few little doodles. I mean, I kid you not, doodles, no more than about that size. And 2 weeks later came into the gallery with this incredible full painting of a woman in a yellow tracksuit sketching across the bridge. And the reason why I said before about his sketching ability is another artist told me you have to practice every day, 5 minutes a day sketching. But he has an ability, not just the way like his father taught him about in sort of a graphic way, but Glenn captures movement. It's not so much the image or the detail, he captures the movement. If you look at the early cricket pictures, they're not so much about the cricketers, it is the movement which he's caught. And if you look at his modern paintings, these latest ones, even that landscape, the tree looks like it's alive. The sky is moving, the stillness of the post has a life about it. There's something hasn't changed in his work. He is able to capture something which is not just a landscape. He really puts life into the work, and not photorealism. He captures it in a way which is the way he captures his drawings. His drawings are really abstract, but it goes into his head and comes out. And I only wish I could draw that. When he says he's shy about drawing, we went to, it was a place in Birmingham called the Jam House, big live venue place. And there was a friend of mine playing. They were big brass band. They were fantastic. And Glenn was just sitting in the balcony, just sketching. And the next minute, there was about half a dozen women around him because he was a good looking geezer, and he still is, bless him. And this one woman just said to him, why don't you sketch me? And he said, yeah, okay, okay. And he's just sketching away. I mean, he did these three paintings, which went into Ronnie Scott's. How he just captured the light and the atmosphere from just minuscule sketches, it's quite phenomenal. And then finally, because I met a lovely actress, Josie Lawrence, and she was performing in London as the King and I, and she was the main female character. And we got invited backstage for the rehearsals, and Glenn was invited for the actual real performance, but he was sitting behind the acting. And this is how good he is. We gave him an exhibition, every single solitary painting sold. And every one of those were alive. And I remember every single one to this very day. He really is a unique artist. It's been a privilege knowing him for 1998, I think. I'm still buying his work. I bet there'll be more. Anyway, you should all have a Glenn Badham in your life because it changes your life forever. Just thought I'd back you up there, Laura. Aww. Hello, Glenn. You've come back. We were just talking about you. Sorry about that.
No. Fantastic. Thanks so much for the wonderful words about an insight in Glenn's artwork and life. It's just obviously you've known Glenn for way longer than I have. And it's amazing to hear the wonderful things you both experience in the art world. And we have now Glenn with us. Yeah, Glenn over here.
Yeah.
And for Ollie's, there's Copenhagen in the background for you to make you feel at home. Hope you recognize that. Glenn, you got to go. Look at the colors.
Yes, absolutely.
Lovely. So I think we got a few more questions for you, Glenn. I'm just trying to go back to the chat box. Well, seems like all the questions have been asked. I've got a few questions for you, Glenn.
Okay.
What draws you to a landscape?
So, as I said just before, would you believe my modem just popped? Never had an issue. And so I'm borrowing my neighbor's Wi-Fi connection, which is very kind of them. Yes, so what draws me to a landscape quite often is that rugged nature. Unfortunately, the end of Lee's testimonial, the sound went, but he was talking about the rocks down in North Devon, where I was working an awful lot up to last year. Those rocks, there's an amazing history associated with wrecking. And shipwrecks. So some people were drawing the ships on in the evening to get the cargo because there wasn't much employment down there. And there's that wonderful history I mentioned, Woolacombe Bay earlier. And Woolacombe Bay is actually Woolacombe, the lovely sandy beach that surfers use. Oh, there, he's just holding the picture up. But that body of water in front of it is called Mort Bay. You've got Mort Ho to the right, and these were famous wrecking points, and in the wrong time of year these would be awash with the dead. There's part a little bit to the right between Woolacombe and Mort Ho itself called Grunter Bay, and allegedly the name comes from where a ship was wrecked full of pigs. And when they got up the next day, the bay was alive with the sound of pigs grunting, and hence it was called Grunter Bay. So there's just this amazing history behind a lot of what we encounter that we're not even aware of, and that really draws me to a place. But quite often it's that rugged. There's something, there's more to a landscape than just sort of a pretty vista. Everything we look at pretty much is managed. If you think about it, we've deforested 87% of our natural woodland. Once upon a time, England was primeval forest and marshland, and now it's arable
pastoral, it's filled with livestock. So everything we consider a beautiful landscape at some point has been tailored for our means to channel the water system or to allow traffic through. So the likelihood of finding this lovely vista is quite remote now. So I tend to look for something a little more rugged, a little more untouched by human hands, or that, as I said earlier, that interface where the two collide, man and nature, and they're the things.
Lovely. Glenn?
Yes.
Where do you see your practice going? How do you see it evolving?
Well, if ultimately I would like to be a legacy painter, somebody remembered for making something special happen. Might sound a bit egotistical, but you know, I'd like to be alongside Ivan Hitchens and the great British painters, Francis Bacon. That is where I would love to be. It's ambitious, I know, but I would ultimately like to be a bit more than commercial. I would like to be in those history books as an artist I'm a huge fan of that Lee knows particularly well, David Prentice, fantastic guy, not as well known as he should be. He set up the I.Art Gallery in Birmingham, fabulous landscape painter, and his work is just knockout good. And probably his work has got a wonderful abstraction about it, especially towards his latter years, those landscapes got a little more loose. And hopefully that's the kind of direction I'll take. If all goes well, God willing, I'll head towards that abstraction. Still recognisable as landscapes, but that's the way I see it going.
A question before I let our guests ask their questions. Mm-hmm. What do you think about Laura I.Art Gallery?
Oh, well, we've known each other for about a year now. It was just before I did two exhibitions, one just before lockdown in that little window. And then I managed to just hang a second exhibition that got closed down after 3 days, unfortunately. However, I was lucky enough to get two real world exhibitions last year. And I was working with Laura I.Art Gallery, on the mentoring side. And I think it paid dividends, the promotional polish on an artist statement or a social media project, all those little bits that contribute, as I said earlier to Emmanuel, there's so much more than just the painting in the studio. As the artist now, you have to be the full package, you know, even being able to make a decent online video, you know, these are the kind of qualities you've got to possess. And thankfully through Laura, I managed to succeed quite well with those two exhibitions. They were very well received, and it's continued going forward. And it's lovely to be part of this stable now. There's a group of 15 of us, as Laura said, and we are in contact. We're on WhatsApp group, and we do pass little things around, anything we find, and support and help each other. So it's given us a nice little peer group to work with as well. So yeah, it's a very, very solid gallery. And it's great to have one thriving in this climate.
Oh, thank you very much, Glenn, for your kind words. We've got one more question from Paula. When did you know your painting vocation? How did it happen? At what age did you know that this is what you want to do, no matter what?
I was probably quite young. When I was at school, I did get decent grades, and all my careers teachers said, go into banking because it's safe and good money. And I kick myself now that, no. But it was about that time, probably 13, 14, when you're just looking at GCSEs, careers are starting to come into your mind. And I'd always got a vision for myself as something in the creative sphere. And I was pushing my art quite hard, went through the foundation course system through university. And it was in those sort of 5 years that I decided, yeah, I think this is the way to go. So it sort of developed quite early on. And then I turned professional pretty much as soon as I graduated. And I've been producing work practice ever since.
Thank you, Glenn. Paula, for your question. We got a few more questions. Wow, questions are coming for you tonight, Glenn. One more question is, any preferences to the size of canvas you like to work on?
Not really size. I like big, but obviously it makes them much more difficult to transport and exhibit. But format-wise, I do tend to like portrait. Now, even though this is a predominantly landscape exhibition, you just cast your eye around, the majority of the pieces are always with a preference for portrait format. And most of these are square or portrait. Yeah. I'd just like to introduce this one piece as well. This one. Hopefully I can just bring this one in. Let me see if I can just get this one coming. Can you see that?
Yes.
So again, it's a nice, simple woodland scene, but there's just this bank of shadow portrait, even though it's a landscape. But that bank of shadow, and I do like that, just a little sense of unease that I've always liked. Little bit like Edward Hopper. Yeah, that the wilderness, and there's that untamed nature, that fear of that in his work, and just that bank of shadow. There's one of his paintings where he's got the road and then the forest beyond, and there's this real sense of foreboding that you don't cross that road because of what's in there. And I love that tension in his work. So although it's, again, looks like a simple landscape, there's that little sense of you can't quite see what's going on in here. Might not be. Okay.
Another question we've got from Emmanuel. How then do you think that materials necessary matters in terms of their brand? Do you get what you pay for, or is it the quality more than the price?
Yeah, definitely. I've started using Schmincke, which I suppose I shouldn't say brands, but as an oil paint, they have really, really good pigment quality. So it is worth paying that bit more for your quality. The stretchers tend to use a company called Cassart, and they make ready-made cross members and beams. So you can get a lovely stretcher like this. Ready-made, you don't have to get all the hard woodworking skill set and all the materials and tools to do it. They will make these lovely cross beams and the canvas on the roll. So I tend to use companies I trust and I've worked with, but my paint quality, yeah, over the years I've learned to buy better and better quality pigments. So Schmincke are pretty good. There's lots out there of that standard, but you know, they're more probably two to three times more than the price of a student quality paint, but you get the benefit of the colour. So yeah, if you can afford it, invest in better quality paint, I'd certainly advise.
Thank you, Glenn. We're going to take one more question from our public. Somebody said that could be our tree in portrait format, Glenn. And Lee says qualify will always prevail. I think these are the questions. Thank you so much, Glenn, for this magical tour of your artwork and for the amazing and colorful views you bring to the art world and the world in general. Before we end our event, I would like to ask Ollie or Lee if they would like to say something, possibly sharing you know, your passion for Glenn's art with us once again. Yes. We can hear.
As I said at the beginning, and Lee put it spot on, the way Glenn paints, it's like you jump into a painting and you arrive in a completely different universe. And as Lee was saying, when he's doing the sketches, and then a couple of weeks later, he comes out with an amazing, absolutely amazing painting. It's just mind blowing. And I can honestly say, just looking at his new paintings, the talent Glenn's got into not just the detailing, because it's almost like the trees are alive. The depth in his paintings, the whole combination, the whole package is absolutely breathtaking. And as I said early on, not just because Lee had the New Haven in the background in his studio, I sincerely hope that Glenn will find time to have an exhibition in Copenhagen so we can really appreciate his fantastic paintings and have more paintings hanging on the walls in Denmark. That would be absolutely fantastic. But for me, it's been fantastic to take part in this exhibition. And as I said, I've known Glenn since 1994, and having his paintings hanging in my house has been, it's been good for my blood pressure, good for my well-being, and it's creating a lot of happiness all around. A lot of love in the air. So Glenn, you are a champion. So keep on painting until you get in your 90s. Then you can go and be a bit more, you know, arty. But keep going. You're doing a fantastic job. And I think that's the final word from your true friend from Copenhagen. So good night to you all. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much, Oli. Wow. Lee, would you like to say something as well to close our exhibition?
Oh, brilliant. Hello, I'm back again. Firstly, Laura, I wish you much success working with Glenn, because he is a star amongst artists. He really is. And secondly, to Glenn directly, is you've always been true to yourself, which so many artists cop out, follow a commercial path and sell their souls. You never have done that. That could be the picture there of your trees could be just a picture of trees. I see dancers. I see life. The movement of that painting. I mean, I'd buy that picture, but you know my house is full of pictures. It's only 148, so I haven't really got much room. But the thing about you is, not only are you selling your work, you need to up your ante and get yourself into things like the Royal West of England, the Royal Academy, the places where, sadly, the majority of people think that's where you've got to be. I do believe that you're... I mean, I walked into a hotel in Jersey and, oh, my God, there's a Glenn Badham golf seat. I was like, whoa, look at that. And it was brilliant. Looking at Ollie's and the cricket pictures, and I remember seeing photographs of those when you first showed me your work, is to come back to the main point is you are true to yourself. You are a true artist. You are a real painter, and you've never compromised. When you've tried to compromise, you fail and you don't do it. You've always, no matter what, been the man with the brush, and the work you do, really, more people deserve to have your work. And I do wish you much success with Laura, and I do wish you much success for the future. And I know those of us that have got your work are really proud of you, but I really believe you are an artist that is ticked to, you know, get up there. So my advice to anybody who hasn't got your work, start buying it now because it will get dearer, hopefully. Cheers, then. Cheers, everybody. Thank you for arranging this exhibition. It's been really nice. It's also lovely to be in a real gallery where at the end of the day, and we've been there, you find there's empty bottles, there's a mess, and you just think, oh, my God. But then luckily there's lots of red dots. So that's what I remember of 14 years of absolute stress, which, as you can see, I haven't got anymore. But, Glenn, you're a true star, and I think you're brilliant. And that's all I want to say. Keep it up. Don't stop.
Thank you so much, Lee. Your words are like honey. Right, so we are getting to the end of our event for today. If you enjoyed our event and you like to keep in touch with us, then please subscribe to our mailing list. The link is in the chat box. We are offering, as I mentioned to you before, only for today, 10% off from any of Glenn's artworks. So if you are interested again to make one of the best deals in your life, if you love Glenn's artwork, please follow our link, which again is in our chat box. I've said that before. Thank you so much, Glenn, for the magical tour of your artwork and for the beautiful and colorful insights into the landscapes. And you help us to look at our surroundings completely, you know, positive and and it's just wonderful to be part of that. I would like to thank so much once again to Ollie and Lee for joining us tonight and for sharing your passion for Glenn's art with us. I would also like to thank our volunteers, Javier and Emmanuel, who make sure that our event tonight run as safe as possible and that no unwanted guests join in. And of course, thank you to all of you for joining us tonight, for showing support, for appreciating art, and for taking time to get to know us a bit better. Glenn, would you like to say something else before we say goodnight?
Yes, just thank you all so much for coming. It's unfortunate this has had to happen. Real world environments are always so much nicer. However, it's wonderful to see so many of you with this kind of enthusiasm for the artwork. Thank you so much to the two volunteers. Thank you to Laura and, of course, Lee and Ollie, two of my longest standing friends and supporters. Great to see you both, albeit in this fashion. But yeah, an absolute pleasure to be here. Absolute pleasure to see you all. And thank you very much.
And remember, you've got about 2 hours to benefit and take advantage of today's offer. So please click on the link in the chat box and on one of Glenn's fantastic artworks and make the best investment of your life. Thank you once again for attending. Wow. And yeah, good night. Bye.